This is the 37th annual show of the Prison Arts Program. There's 797 artworks in the show. 797 artworks, floor to ceiling, wall to wall. The Community Partners in Action used to be the Connecticut Prison Association. It was initiated in 1875. Mark Twain was on one of the first boards of directors. The art from prison, indicative of most of the art, is an obsessive compulsive amount of time is spent on the work. You know, an artwork will be filled with hundreds of hours of small markings. You know, utilizing the time. We're looking at these frames that are made out of toilet paper boxes and Bristol board and coffee, colored pencils. People will use non-dairy creamer as a type of adhesive or Bondo to make things out of toilet paper. I mean, primarily the materials that you're going to use in the prison, beyond those, you know, whatever you can find, food, you know, whatever you can find, is small paper that you can't hide behind, right? So 19 by 24 is usually like the largest piece of paper you're going to find, and so you can make something huge by piecing it together. But it's going to be direct materials. It's not going to be, it's nothing flammable, it's not going to be oil paint, it's not going to be acrylic for the most part. It's very difficult to get acrylics. There's a very minimal art supply commissary list of what you can get. We try to bring art supplies in where it's a facility by facility, you know, situation of what we're allowed to bring in and what we're allowed to distribute. And so for us to come in and say, you know, what's going on to the left of that drawing? What's going on to the right? Use the tip of the pencil, spend 100 hours on it. All of a sudden, it's just a totally, you know, that provocation just changes the way they make their work. And I think that a lot of the work, and I think these annual shows, you know, anyone can submit work. So you're going to have artwork in the show that comes from anywhere. And then you're going to have someone in the workshop who's making, you know, artwork that doesn't have a center, you know, or an artwork that literally took 700 hours to make, you know, and exists well beyond the borders of the piece of paper itself. So people are using everything, and people spend different amounts of time on things, and it's very varied. You can't buy models in prison. That's not something you can buy through commissary, or you can order and have mailed in. So it makes every part out of, started with paper and now with Bristol board, which is a cardstock, and started, you know, cutting out pieces, adhering it with non-dairy creamer, and now uses glue that he gets to sit in the gym and use the glue, and he makes these trucks and these helicopters and these planes and these cranes where the drive shaft works, the axles work, the engines, turn, the doors open, the steering wheels turn. There are these marvels of ingenuity and, you know, engineering, and they're made out of paper. Beyond just talking about the staggering artwork that comes from, that is generated in the prisons, you know, initiated by the Prison Arts Program, and that only exists because these specific artists exist and because, you know, the program exists, I think the most important aspect of the program, and an important aspect that people don't really think about, is that the prison is so different than the world outside. So you could be in this forced contemplative environment for decades, and you could have these revelations about yourself, what it is to be a human being, about how to live this brief time you have on the planet, how you're not an island unto yourself, how you have to interact with other people, how do you successfully interact with other people, what are like sensible priorities, what are satisfying priorities. And so just me coming into the prisons, just an artist coming into the prison to teach art, to initiate art collectives in various prisons, to initiate positive constructive endeavors, which is what we're doing. That's basically all it is. I'd say that that's bringing sanity into the prison. And that's bringing a connection to the outside world that will make the revelations you have in that workshop and in the weeks between that workshop, it'll make those revelations pertinent. Pertinent when you're released, or if you're never released, pertinent in the way it affects someone else who might be released, the way it affects your family who are in the outside world. You know, every year at the opening, it's wall-to-wall families. You know, so you'll have a daughter running up to their father's artwork and getting their pictures taken with it. You know, so proud. The dignity bestowed upon the artist by having their work in the show, and then their family witnessing this dignifying experience. You know, it's priceless, obviously, it's priceless. It's priceless if it's your dad, you know, that you all you know is the worst, and or all that's reaffirmed is the worst, to be able to read about him in the paper making this extraordinary work, or seeing someone positively comment on your dad's artwork, is huge. But I think, like, more complicated than that is that often you'll have, say, a mom, and she just can't put together her son with the crime her son committed. Just can't, it just doesn't add up. She can't bring herself to go to the prison to visit her son. And you'll have moms that will come, you know, 6-7 times to the show over the course of the month to stand in front of their son's artwork, to try to connect to their son. That it initiates these connections. I think last year, you know, one of the most powerful pieces in the show, there's an artist, James Taylor, who doesn't write, you know, beautiful pop songs. It turns out, you know, he went to prison. His daughter was, I believe, 2 years old when he went to prison. His entire relationship for 15 years has been through sending artwork home, you know? And she submitted his artwork that he'd sent her for 15 years and wrote about it. And he wrote about building a relationship with her through the artwork. It was so powerful, incredible. And you don't think about that. We give people in prison the tools to constructively communicate with their families, to get the ball rolling, to have something to talk about, to be able to talk about in a sophisticated way. You know, I think that one of the things that we've been talking about recently in the classes is about interacting with your family, which is something we do. It's not just about the quality of line and shading and exploring, you know, what's possible with your art and the way you think. And we were talking about how it's important to remind your family and to remind yourself that you're both growing and changing all the time. No one in the world exists solely in relation to ourselves, you know? And that's not an art lesson, that's a person lesson that is a real powerful one. You know, I'm very interested in the art. I'm very interested in encouraging people to make art, and art that's unique, art that only exists because they exist. But I'm also interested, I have a family. I'm also interested in people leaving the prisons better capable of being my neighbor. And I know that this work makes my children safer. And I think that you can appreciate this work for the work. The artwork is amazing. It's incredible. There's no hyperbole. I can't describe to you, you know, the 1,000 hours that this artwork took to make. I can't describe it to you. Here is someone working out every thought that they have, you know, in 7 volumes of a book over the course of a year. The artwork is incredible. Encouraging everyone in his block to make these artworks, to sell, to have all the proceeds go to benefit research into children's cancer. I mean, that's incredible. The artwork is incredible to look at. You look at all this artwork, it is incredible to look at. Where are all these artworks coming from? The artwork is wild. The artwork is incredible. You know, where do these artworks come from? Throughout the whole show, all these are people, these are all people living in this crazy limbo world, and what's happening to them is shaping their future and is shaping the future of our community. And that's pretty big, I'd say. Your students are gonna say things that they would never think to say. You're gonna do things together that you would never think that you would be doing, accomplishing incredible things. And you're reminded of what an incredible opportunity it is. You're reminded what an incredible thing it is to honestly and sincerely interact with people and to go into the prison with no idea what you're gonna do. You don't come in with a curriculum. You don't come in with, I'm gonna teach them how to do this today. You come in, you have no idea what's gonna happen, and you react, and your students react, and you see what happens, and all of a sudden something happens that's amazing, you know, amazing. And it's not inexplicable, you could explain it. You could explain it because we're sensitive to what's going on, we're being honest, and we have every reason to accomplish something, and we have all the tools to accomplish something. And, I'm obviously incredibly lucky to be doing that. And what the program's evolved into is everyone's, you know, we've established art collectives in all these different prisons. We're encouraging people to make art that only exists because they exist. They learn from each other. They feed off each other. The bar is raised so high of what's possible, and anything is possible. And art people have artwork all over the world. And it just evolved into this thing where the art could come from Mars. It's not some, you know, tap patterns in, you know, innocuous beach landscapes. It's, you know, who knows, you know, what people are up to, you know? You got a building of books here, right? Look at this drawing over here, the passage, you know? And he's got 118 of them in the show this year. 118 that he made this year. And they're, you know, I mean, there's this, the water, there's like these, you know, drips of water dripping in almost all along, you know, the outside world somehow getting in, or, you know, contamination from one place into another. They're woven through the whole show, so that you end up, you know, getting caught sightseeing, looking at something pretty. It brings you back to the fact that, you know, the work could come from anywhere, but it turns out it all comes from prison. That's a great example of the prison arts program, right? Is that you got a guy that is now submitting 118 inexplicable drawings that he does in the gym while he's distributing the weight pins, and that's a normal thing that's going on in the prisons in the state of Connecticut, thanks to the prison arts program. You got people weaving bracelets made out of unraveled shirts. Prison art fights children's cancer. You have people making ambiguous abstract drawings, exploring, you know, wherever it ends up going. And I think that's, you know, that's the victory of the prison arts program. So one of the projects that we ask guys to do and women to do now, when they first come, is to, I've been asking them to imagine their museum. It's just got your artwork in it. What's in that museum? Where is it? Is it on the moon? Is it in the drawer next to your, in a cabinet next to your bed when you were 5 years old? Where is it? You know, is it in a, you know, is it underwater? Is it in the prison itself? Is it in your pocket? Does it span from here to the moon? What's in it? And the things that people think to make are just incredible. And I think that that's the program, you know, that's it right there. Is we're encouraging people to make things right now, but really we're encouraging people to think about themselves making work till they're 80, and what is it, and beyond. And the results are extraordinary. You know, that's the thing that's so incredible about the program, is it's constantly evolving. It's constantly growing. It's constantly itself becoming more sophisticated. The artists are becoming more sophisticated. The energy, the participation is, you know, an amped up level every year. And hopefully the recognition, you know, in the state, in the area, and throughout the world will continue to grow. I mean, I can't imagine it wouldn't continue to grow. This is a wonder of the world. Obviously, I'm a teacher, so you know, you end up really caring about your students. It's just the way it works out, is that you end up having these incredible conversations with your students, and you really care about the development of their way of thinking, their abilities, their emotional state in regard to their artwork. But I will tell you that invariably, I get to work, you know, I'm seeing people at their best. They're, you know, there's huge waiting lists to get in the workshop. They're very happy to be in the workshop. It's one of the great moments of the prison day, of the prison week, of their prison life. And it's probably the moment where they feel most human and most successful at being human, if they even think about that. If any of us ever even think about that, if you thought about it in that moment, you'd be like, wow, I'm really, this is a good moment of being a person. And I would say that, you know, the majority of the people that I work with in prison, their default action, if they were startled into action, would be a good action. And what it tells me is that people are very complicated, and the person that's capable of doing the worst thing in the world is also the person that's capable of doing the greatest, most compassionate, positive, empathetic, selfless thing, right? People will go to prison for the rest of their lives for something so out of character, so extraordinarily almost impossible. If you roll the dice of their life a million times, something happened that one time. And that's their life. The rest of their life is in prison, right? And someone else, you know, the odds of them doing something messed up and selfish would be much greater, but, you know, it never worked out that way, you know? So they get to walk free. It's complicated, you know? I mean, it's all complicated, but all I could say is that, you know, we build these prisons, we might as well do something while we're in prison. Obviously, the Prison Arts Program takes advantage of a horrible situation, right? The majority of these people, you know, wouldn't be like, oh yeah, sure, I'll join your art workshop. I'll initiate an art collective with you. They wouldn't, but in prison they do. And, you know, so we're gonna take advantage of this horrible situation while hoping to eventually, you know, initiate some type of change. I hope we're initiating change. I hope, you know, we conclude some incredible endeavor of changing the prison system so that it's positive, it's constructive, without question. Budget is less than $100,000 a year, and we rely on, you know, staff, ourselves volunteering, and having volunteers assist, having incredible spaces like this one donated for use. This is obviously, you know, amazing. The work's amazing. The collective work is amazing. The main thing about it is the culmination of a year's endeavor by everyone in the prison system, and hopefully we'll get more and more state involvement, and voc ed involvement, and school involvement. Correctional.